June is fast approaching, and that means payment of bills and loans will restart, if they haven't yet, after being deferred for 2 months because of the pandemic. It's important to note that missing a payment may damage a key tool to function in the financial system, your credit rating, which banks use to judge your level of risk as a borrower and determine your rate or whether your application gets approved or not in the first place. This afternoon, we talk about how to keep your credit score healthy during the COVID-19 crisis with no less than the president and CEO of state-run credit information corporation, Jaime Garchitorena. Hi, Jaime. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, good afternoon, and it's nice to be here.
So, Jaime, at a time when banks are going to be extra careful about the loans they give out on concerns, you know, this crisis will mean more jobless people, companies out of business that may not be able to repay, what role will you and CIC play?
Okay, so maybe it's just a quick briefer. Mm-hmm. The CIC gathers credit data, which means payments or non-payments, from all the covered financial institutions, which generally speaking covers almost any formal lender in the Philippines, all the way from credit cards to microfinance institutions and everything else in between. So we have all the data of your payments or non-payments over at least the last 5 years. Now, over the last 2-3 months of the pandemic and the ECQ, I'm sure the financial institutions have already been reviewing their portfolios and have been also calibrating their credit risk profiles to be able to see how they can sustain their customer base. But coming into June, the CIC will be very helpful because from a data perspective, the COVID-19 situation is no different from any other natural disaster that forces the borrower to not be able to pay the lender. And so it's going to be important for all the lenders not to look at the status of the payment during the natural disaster like COVID-19, but look at the previous payment behavior of at least 6 to 12 months prior to the disaster to be able to say, first of all, was this client a good client of mine based on my current portfolio management policies? What are the conditions now? Has he been in touch with me or across the ECQ? He couldn't pay or he can pay, but he just doesn't have the means to get to me. And then moving forward, review the entire portfolio again with any number of other additional matters like government supports and subsidies, and build another set of risk profiles to see high risk, low risk, and medium risk clients, and then act accordingly. So that's our role there, to provide the data from before ECQ. And also, just to let you know that any payment or non-payment recorded in the ECQ, when you draw your credit report, there will be a note that this is an ECQ period. So anyone looking in the future at why someone missed the payment from, let's say, March to June, will know that this was an ECQ situation and know that there was some type of suspension for the declaring of defaults.
That's very considerate. Just to clarify, Jaime, a CIC will not give a credit score. You don't give a credit score from a low of 300 to a high of 850, right? You simply store the data, which
right.
would then be accessed by credit agencies, credit bureaus, who will process the data, do the math, and come up with a final credit score, correct?
Right. So the CIC just collects the data. It's just payment, non-payment, nothing in between.
Okay. And how extensive is your database? I know that as of end March, you already had around 11.3 million unique individuals in your database and 83,000 companies.
Right. So those are fairly accurate numbers. We also have over 50 million contracts, I think, on our last count. But just to let everyone know that we will also be implementing a system enhancement, because one of the major gaps within the CIC database is MFI data, because essentially some of the data in the MFI may not normally fall within the parameters of CIC collection standards. So for the period moving forward, MFI data will be subjected to a particular type of process, and whereas they were not able to submit data before, they will be able to submit data now. So starting around July, they should be able to not only access their credit data from us, but be able to find out if they're exposed, the exposure of their borrowers are also exposures of other lenders, and they will be able to go to our credit bureaus and say, hey, help me adjust my portfolio, help me figure this out. How can I retain my clients? How can I make terms better, terms longer, without losing money or without losing the client?
So you mentioned I can check my data, I can pull out my record with CIC?
Well, right now, we're moving into GCQ, so we will start operations, but it'll be at least 2 weeks before anyone can come to the CIC office to get their credit reports. However, I think within the next 3 weeks or a month or so, our credit bureau should be able to implement some kind of online KYC, which means we should be able to get credit reports online very soon.
And can I contest the content? Can I complain?
Absolutely.
That's not me. That didn't happen to me.
Absolutely.
A dispute resolution
Absolutely.
Mechanism.
So we have what we call an online dispute resolution system. Most of it is online. We're moving all of our systems online. And the moment they enter their dispute, assuming that they get a credit report from us, they can encode the credit report number as a means of validating that they did get a credit report from the CIC. And then that will start the process of dispute. We will get in touch with the lender that's indicated. We will get in touch with the borrower who made the complaint. And we'll monitor this process so that hopefully within about 20 days, the entire process, the entire dispute has been resolved, hopefully in favor of the borrower.
Mm-hmm. Give us the big picture, Jaime. How does the average Filipino's credit standing look like? Are you seeing trends? Do you have estimates, percentage of the population, at least in your universe, who are able to pay on time, or the percentage unable to meet obligations before this COVID-19 pandemic?
Well, we don't have that data right off, but when speaking to our borrowers, the contributors of the data, obviously they wouldn't be in a position of being profitable lenders if majority of their borrowers were in default. So they say that Filipinos are very good at paying. When they can pay, they will pay. When they can only pay a small amount, they will pay a small amount, which is why it's important to make the distinction between people who weren't able to pay before COVID as a matter of habit, which means they really were bad borrowers, versus those that had the history of regularly paying, whether in full or partial amount. So Filipinos in general are known to be good payers, and we want to make sure that the good payment behaviors of these Filipino borrowers are not only just recorded, but they can actually convert into a credit score that at some point will be able, they can leverage off that to get better terms than those who don't pay, just to be fair.
Uh-huh. And do you have estimates what percentage of the population you think will be vulnerable to missing payments in this crisis? I know you said there will be a note that this non-payment was due to the lockdown, the 2 month. But this is not just, you know, I imagine with unemployment expected to spike, some of these people will not only be unable to pay during the lockdown, but after, even after the lockdown, when they lose jobs or when business is bad moving forward.
Right. So anecdotally speaking, you're talking about first, small businesses will probably have a very hard time keeping up with payments, which means the government, which is why the government is trying to do everything it can to support support the small business owners. I've heard of things like negative interest loans or of guaranteed loans just to keep people hired. But you can also see that after that, once the small businesses start failing, those who are from paycheck to paycheck or are trying to borrow a little bit more than their paycheck every month just to pay for, let's say, additional education for their children or healthcare, those will begin to fail soon as well. So there's a very particular demographic that's going to be affected. Those that rely on their livelihood with small businesses are definitely at risk because the businesses where they derive income from will be at risk as well. So in general, I can't speak of an actual number, but that's a natural cascade of this kind of pandemic.
That's pretty scary considering that majority of the business establishments are micro, small, and medium enterprises who, as you mentioned, depend on the day-to-day operations with very short runways. They depend on the daily operations. Jaime, final question. You know, we're living at a time of widespread economic insecurity. How is this pandemic making you rethink and rework your strategy? Are there things that you've realized today that you didn't really think much of before?
Well, from a CIC perspective, it used to be that we used to push on compliance. So that was our messaging, comply, 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 because it is a law. So now we're pushing harder on the actual benefit. We're working with the banks to make sure they understand, why do they need to submit 5 years of historical data or 3 years of historical data? Why do they need to keep updated? It's not just for compliance. It is not only to support their business as lenders, but to support the borrowers as their clients. So we have a theme that says, go beyond compliance. And I think that's going to be a very strong theme moving forward as we find a solution to the COVID-19 virus.
Okay, on that note, thank you very much, Jaime, for joining us this afternoon. Keep well.
Oh, thank you very much, and same to you.